It's you again. Yeah, it's definitely windy. Are you alone? Okay. You wanted to hear more stories again? Yeah, I have a few for you again. Did you find anybody for the door? It's still here. No. I wonder whose door is it? Either way, please wipe your feet. I don't want any dirt on my food. Okay, come on in. Let me go find some more mysterious stories and objects. Just for you. These are my keys. They're from different kinds of doors. I keep them for emergency situations, so that I have a key for any door that I need unlocked. How do I know which one is which? You know, you sometimes ask a lot of questions. For being a guest. Watch. Why do I have it? I don't know. It doesn't work anymore. But I like it. So now it's here telling me how little time I have left. So one day, I stumbled upon the most incredible purse I have ever seen at the yard sale. It looked to be 100 years old. I paid full price for it. I had to have it. As soon as I saw it, my hands started glowing and shaking. I knew it was destiny. So, as I looked inside the purse, it was not a regular inside of the purse. Instead, I found myself staring into a different world. Yeah. So I embarked on a long journey, tracking down any information I could find about this purse. And I discovered... Come here. And I discovered that this was an ancient of this wonderful realm. Look inside. No. I can give you a listen. Every time I close and open this purse, a new world opens up in front of me. Every time. Sometimes it's landscapes, sometimes rainforests, different worlds. Sometimes it's cities. Ancient and futuristic. And it's all mine. Only mine. Here, I have three keys, one for each bedroom of mine. I like to lock my bedrooms because, you know, who knows, sometimes the doors fall off and I feel like the lock will hold it together. Sometimes people come in and you don't want them to be here, so they don't want to get in the bedroom, you know. And this is a secret, beautiful ring. You can wear it like so. It's ancient, I'm telling you. You can open it. You can hide a little bit. Somebody get poisoned with it. I don't know those people, but I am keeping it just in case I ever get a guest who learns a little too much. A little too much, no, you know? Then I'll offer them some tea and we'll be best friends. Did I offer you tea recently? Just kidding. Let me tell you a little bit about a mirror. this. So let me tell you a little bit about this magical mirror. It's not only a mirror, it's also lipstick. It's not just a simple lipstick and mirror. Every time I open it, and apply it on my lips, like so. It magically appears on my lips when I look into this mirror. It's a true magic. You wanna see? That neat? Oh yeah. We're gonna keep it forever. How about some book? I found this one book by author Martha Shinley. Mainly this author was writing books for children, and when I found it, I had to have it and share it with you. Let me show you inside. It's in a pretty good condition for being from 1800s. Let me read some for you. Preface. Several other writers, having undertaken the task of setting forth the faults and foibles of the girl of the period, that's the name of her book, and furnishing her with a model for imitation, the thought arose in my mind that it might not be amiss for me to try to do the same service for the boy. This book is the result of that thought and the effort to carry it out. I do not offer Fred Landon to you, my young friends, as a perfect example. He has his faults, like the rest of us, and you may improve upon the model as much as you will. But if my little story shall amuse and instruct you, and while it does this, shall also convince you of the beauty of old-fashioned obedience to parental and other lawful authority, respect for superiors, and chivalrous conduct towards the weak and defenseless, and above all, shall stir up those of you to whom we trust will one day be committed, earnestly to watch over and defend the liberties of our beloved land, putting down every form of lawlessness and vice, and seeing to it that our laws are made and executed by good men. And true, it will have accomplished its mission. dignity and a lot of old-fashioned views that are sometimes forgotten, but should be in some cases reminded, since people have lived their lives and have created wisdom in certain areas of life that we can, remember, take some notes without all of them. Chapter 1. Fred's disappointment. Fred, my son, you're not angry with your mother. The low, pleading tones of the voice he loved best on earth sent a keen pang to the boy's heart. He could not control his own answer on the instant. A fierce battle was raging within his breast, and until the victory was gained over pride and resentment, he dared not trust himself to speak. He stood still before one of the windows of his mother's dressing room, his back toward the little sewing chair she sat by the other, and his face resolutely averted from her. "Oh, my boy, my dear boy," she sighed, "will you turn against me? You have been my earthly stay and support through all my dreary widowhood. I think it is rather that my mother has turned from me," he said bitterly. Then, with a burst of grief, "Mother, mother, you don't need me now." "Don't need you, my son? Oh, Fred, such a reproach from you." The pain in the beloved voice was more than he could bear. "I'm a brute," he said, turning quickly and coming to her side with a face full of pettiness through the angry flush though the angry flush had scarce died out of it yet. "Forgive me, darling little mother. My dear boy, I meant it all for good," she whispered, drawing him down to embrace him, and laying her cheek to his, while he felt her hot tears on his neck. "Oh, believe your mother when she tells you that she sought her children's welfare as well as her own. I thought we all needed a guide and protector, Fred. It is my nature to seek to lean up on a stronger arm, and you cannot realize how sorely I have missed your dear father. Don't, dear mother, I can't bear to see you cry. But oh, could you not have leant upon your son? I have tried to supply his place to you, and to Lena also, as he bade me with his dying. And you did nobly, my dear boy," she said, smoothing back the rich chestnut locks from his broad, wide forehead, pressing her lips upon it. "But you are young, only 17, and could not advise me about business matters, and Mr. Rush can, and as a specimen of his wise management, persuades you." Look on the dear face stopped the angry outbreak, and he closed his lips firmly. "Oh, Fred, will you make trouble between us? Trouble and sorrow for your mother?" she asked in tones tremulous with emotion. that I never will. But you don't know what a disappointment it is to me to give up my studies just now, when 2 more years would have taken me through. And I hoped to graduate with high honors and make you and Lena so proud of me. And it was what my father planned and approved too. Oh, it's hard, very hard, to give it all up. You cannot guess how hard. I think I can, my poor dear boy, she said, softly stroking his hair. But Ullman is quite certain it will be best for you in the end. And it is to be only for a time, you know. Probably a year, at farthest. And then you will go back to your studies. And 20 will be quite early enough to graduate. Besides, will it not be some comfort? Does it not help to reconcile you to the change of plans? That you will be constantly with your mother and sister while you're out at the college. Thought brightens the near future very much for me, my son. And I'm sure it will for Lena too. When she